We are going to start with the sixth unit. It is about the protection of HVDC systems. In this chapter mainly, it consists of studying various protection schemes related to HVDC substation and so also the insulation coordination. So we'll begin our discussion with respect to defining the protective zones in HVDC system. As far as the protection is concerned, we must understand basically why protection is needed for power systems or HVDC system. The main idea here is that there may be certain abnormal operating conditions due to disturbances on the AC side of the network or due to some fault, okay, due to some unlikely events like lightning, overvoltages or transients in the system, failure of the converter valves, any other abnormal operating condition that leads to short circuit or maybe overcurrent and overvoltage or transients. In such a case, the system must either be robust to overcome these conditions on its own, or the system must be provided something additional safety against such abnormal conditions if it is not capable of withstanding the abnormal conditions. Okay, so considering this fact, the protective system comes into picture. So for understanding the protective systems, we must analyze what is the requirement of the protective system. Okay, kindly take a look at the simple schematic diagram. It consists of converters. Okay, we can see here there are converters, 12 pulse converters, right? And then we have converter transformers, isn't it? Next, we have the filters, right? Filters for converter 1, and then similarly here, filters down here at the bottom. So converters, converter transformers, filters. Then we have here on the other side, positive or maybe DC line 1, DC line 2. So these are the major components of HVDC system which require protection. Fine. And on the left hand side, this particular part, you can see this is a bus, okay, converter AC side bus, AC supply bus. This also requires protection. There are certain circuit breakers and isolators connected here. So kindly observe that all these various elements, that is converters, converter transformers, filters, right, then DC lines, all of these components, when they are in operation for continuously for a very long duration of time, right, they may undergo certain abnormal operating conditions which are called as either temporary disturbances or permanent disturbances known as faults. There are different types of faults, very similar to the faults which are experienced in the AC network. There may be a line to ground fault on the DC line, or there may be line to ground fault on the AC side of a converter transformer. Okay, there may be winding short circuit on the transformer. Okay, there may be short circuit across the wall bridge legs, okay, or arms of the bridges, right? There may be failure of the valve, right? There may be misfiring of the valves, or maybe failure in the conduction pattern of the valves or thyristors. They may not conduct in proper sequence. All these conditions, they are classified as faults, and they may lead to development of conditions which will disturb the power flow and has to be rectified at the earliest. So as far as these agencies are concerned, we know that for protecting a fault in the circuit, we have to divide this complete system in the form of protective zones, right? Where do we require protection? So there are various protective zones. How do we define zones? So zones are actually defined based upon the system to be protected. For example, I would like to protect this HVDC converter bridge, right? This is one three-phase bridge, this is another three-phase bridge. So together they are connected in series to obtain 12 pulse operation. So protective zones are defined based upon the major equipments that are to be protected, or major portion of the HVDC station that is to be protected. So various protective zones are defined in this particular case. You can see here that they are labeled as one, right? So this is converter AC bus protection. There you can see it is indicated by a dash and dot line. So one zone will be defined that we have to give some protection strategy here, or maybe some protection for this particular area, that is protection zone one, right? Then second, here it is indicated, okay? So you can observe that this particular is a very big zone, right? From here all the way, okay? Then coming all the way here, okay? And then moving down like this. So this particular big area covered by this green line that I have highlighted, all the things that are covered inside it, okay? That is one major protective zone called as a DC pole zone. This is a DC pole and DC line. Okay, so all the equipment that are associated with upper line, right? Converter, converter transformer, corresponding filter, and a section of bus, that will be coming under the pole, DC pole zone, indicated by two. Okay, first one is a AC converter bus. Okay, this is pole zone one. Then zone two, major zone. Okay, that is DC pole zone. If you observe carefully, then within this zone, DC pole zone, right, there are sub zones. So three, you can see this three here, this, isn't it? So I'll just highlight that particular portion, zone three, right? This particular zone, it indicates that it is a filter zone. Okay, it is a filter zone. And similar zones exist on the other side of the DC line. The other DC line also has got its own converter transformer. Okay, so similar zone will exist at the bottom. Next is a converter transformer zone. Okay, converter transformer zone. Further, next is a converter zone. Okay, converter also requires protection. And then third one is a so you can see first, second, third, filter zone, fourth, converter transformer zone, then fifth you can see here, this one, okay? So this feeder zone, okay? Converter is receiving three phase AC supply, so this is a feeder zone, five, okay? Then sixth is a converter, and seventh is the DC line zone, and lastly the eighth, here you can see eighth is a neutral bus, or the earthing, isn't it? Earth electrode, so neutral bus zone, right? It is generally used in case of emergency. If one of the poles is down, then this particular earth return. So earth return, the neutral bus zone, that is eight. So different protective zones are there. Different protective zones are there, but most importantly, you have to notice here something very, very important, that is, kindly focus here in this area, similarly in this area, right? And similarly in all such areas, right? What you observe here is that the zone one, isn't it? It overlaps with zone two. There is an overlap, right? Similarly, zone 3, it overlaps with zone 2. Okay, you can see, similarly see here, zone 1, zone 5 and zone 4. So zone 5, it has an overlap with zone 4 and so also with zone 1. Then zone 4 also has an overlap on the other side with respect to zone 6. Then zone 6 and zone 7, they also have an overlap. So what is the idea here? What is the idea? The idea here is that if the zones are not overlapping like this, isn't it? If I have one zone like this and the other zone for converter like this, isn't it? So in that case, what will happen is that there is some part of the system which is not having any protective relay or zone. If there is a fault in this area, in the middle of these two zones, then neither zone 7 is looking at it nor zone 6 is looking at it. It is like the protective area that is defined for a particular zone relay, isn't it? Relay 6 will not look into fault beyond its boundary. Similarly, relay 7 will not look into a fault beyond its boundary. So this is coming out to be a blind spot. This particular area is coming out to be a blind spot if the zones are not overlapping. So a good protective system or a good protection system should ensure in first place that different types of zones are decided in such a way that there are no blind spots. No area is left out from any particular zone. Always some part of the area will be checked by both the protective zones. Okay, this overlap is required in order to prevent such a situation where there is a blind spot. None of the zones are looking at that. Okay, if there is a fault there, neither 6 will be able to rectify nor 7. Okay, so that is why there is an overlap. If there is a fault here, then the two relays, relay at zone 6 as well as relay at zone 7, will be able to rectify it. But depending upon the severity of the fault, there may be a time difference in the operation of these two relays. So that is what is called as a time grading. If this fault is having more impact on the line, then 7 should operate first. If this fault is having more impact on converter, then 6 must operate first, and then as a backup 7 will operate. So overlapping protective zones have its own advantage, that one of the zones will act as a primary protection for that particular area and the other will act as a backup zone. Okay, that is for the overlapping region. But you can have primary and backup protection for one particular zone area with respect to the other relay preceding it, okay, on the line side or maybe on the load side. So this is the idea why the protective zones are required. Okay, in this whole scheme, there are two major protective zones, right? And those two major protective zones, already one I highlighted earlier, you can see here, this, okay, coming all the way here, okay, then moving all the way here like this. This is one zone, right? And then you can consider here the next one. Okay, this is next. Observe second zone. Okay, just highlight this one. So you see, this is a blue one major zone and then green other major zone. So HVDC system is broadly classified into two zones, pole one zone. So for pole 1 zone, it is for line 1, and then pole 2 zone, it is for line 2, like this, okay, for line 2. So line 1, pole zone complete, it involves everything, converter transformer, filter, AC bus, and all the other agencies, isolator circuit, whatever. Okay, then next is pole 2 zone. So broadly, it is classified into two zones. This you have to understand and remember very well, okay. So the equipments, they have faults, different equipment. Filters have their own type of faults. Some faults are temporary in nature. Some faults are permanent in nature. Transformer have some kind of faults. Okay. Maybe the winding short circuit or to the ground fault, okay, or maybe incipient fault, overheating. There's so many things are there, okay. But how they are taken care? So first we define the zones according to the major equipments, right? Then we try to make sure that the zones, they overlap, okay. So naturally there will be a question in our mind, how the zones can be met to overlap. The idea is fairly simple. The idea is fairly simple that whenever we want to make the zones to overlap, let us say I want to make these two zones overlap, right? So what I am going to do is that I am going to put a particular relay here, okay, right? Okay, this is for zone 6. And zone 6, one of the relays I'll put on this side, maybe CT will be sensing that one. And zone 7 CT location, I'll put it here. CTs will be able to, CTs and PTs according to the type of fault. Okay, so for zone 6, right, for zone 6, I'm going to put a particular current transformer for fault detection in this area. Okay, just a minute. Here. And for zone 7, I am going to put a CT on the other side. So what will happen is that current detection for zone 6 is being done slightly on the zone 7 side, and similarly current detection for zone 7 is being done slightly on the zone 6 side. So that whatever happens here is seen by zone 6 as well as it is seen by zone 7. So since you have studied switchgear and protection, you realize what is the importance of proper positioning of the current transformers, potential transformers, in order to decide the protective zones and cover all the areas, leaving no blind spots. Right. So keeping this in mind, let us now move ahead and see what are the different zones. So different zones have been marked here, right, that we have already seen on the diagram. Okay, first one is a substation, AC substation zone, or I told you that AC converter bus zone. Okay, then second is a DC pole 1 zone, major zone. Similarly, there will be DC pole 2 zone, AC filter protection zone, and then converter transformer zone, AC bus pole 1 zone, okay, DC converter pole 1 zone. So these are all labeled, okay, AC bus pole zone 1. Okay, 5, it was between the converter bus and a converter transformer, that area. Then DC converter pole zone 1, okay, and the other remaining zones, these are already labeled. And lastly, you can see here that I was telling that electrode line, it is required for protecting the electrode line, the one that carries current to the earth electrodes. This also requires protection. It is also prone to faults, right? Okay. Next is, how do we classify the faults at HVDC substation, HVDC terminal station, right? So various types of faults are there. First is a fault on DC lines. It's a very common. Maybe line to ground fault, lightning over voltage may cause insulator to flash over, and it will lead to fault, line to ground fault. Fault on the converters. Converter faults, these are like most of the converter faults, they are of self-clearing nature. And since converter control, it acts very fast based on firing angle control. So most of these faults, they are self-clearing in nature. If not, then the converter firing pulses are blocked and it is protected. So faults on the converter, okay. Commutation failure, then arc through, misfire, arc quenching, all those are there, okay. Then faults on the converter transformer. Transformer faults, you might have studied, maybe line to ground fault or short circuit, okay. Primary side, secondary side, okay. That is there. Fault on the AC filters, again, these are like mainly overcurrent type of faults take place in AC filters. Okay, filter components may get heated. If they fail, then it leads to fault, failure of insulation. Fault on the bus bar or AC substation, and then fault on the electrode line. So basically, through this complete range, right, various types of faults are listed here, because we would like to provide protection to the HVDC terminal station, so we must not leave any area, isn't it? So everything is covered: line fault, converter fault, transformer fault, filter fault, bus fault, electrode line fault, all areas they are addressed here, right? Let us now check with the idea of DC line faults. Okay, first and foremost fault that is listed in the set of faults, that is the DC line fault here. Okay, again the short circuit. Now we are going to discuss that one, that how the short circuit or DC line faults are taken care of. So for a bipolar HVDC link, right, single line to ground fault will occur mainly due to the lightning. Okay, it will mainly occur due to lightning and flashover across the insulation. If lightning occurs, so insulator may flashover. That means current will flow over the surface of the insulator. Okay, and it will lead to conduction, because lightning, it carries large amount of energy. And of course, there may be overhead ground conductor for protection against lightning. But if lightning strikes on the line, in that case, what will happen? So that leads to the creation of flashover. And flashover means that ground, the line conductor will be temporarily connected to the ground over the insulator surface, and energy discharge will take place. Most of the time, these kind of faults are temporary, and they involve only one pole, that is either a positive line or a negative line. Okay, a positive pole or negative pole. Okay, and line pole protection, it is directly has an interface with respect to the converter control unit. Okay, so as soon as there is a line to ground fault on any one of the lines, even though it is temporary in nature, but the operating mode is shifted to monopolar. From bipolar mode, it is shifted to monopolar, and current will be transferred to the ground as a return. So this I have been telling you since the very beginning, when we started the study of HVDC scheme, way back in the third unit. So I was telling that there is earth electrode and earth return, that current can be carried through the earth path for extended period of time in case there is a fault. Okay, if the fault is temporary, then immediately the current is transferred back to the line conductor. But if the fault is permanent, then extended period also operation can be done in the monopolar mode. Okay, so for this kind of fault, that is a line to ground fault on a DC line or a short circuit fault, let us understand what is a fault clearing process. So very, very important topic in terms of understanding functioning of DC, right? Fault clearing, fault detection and fault clearing process. You'll be surprised to know that for HVDC system, even in case of line to ground fault, the fault current is not allowed to exceed a value higher than the current margin, that is not more than 10 to 15% between difference between the DC current reference at the rectifier end and at the inverter end. So generally, whenever there is a line to ground fault, the HVDC system do not employ any circuit breaker for isolating the fault. No circuit breaker is used. This is mainly due to the fact that the fault current that results due to such a line to ground fault is limited quickly by virtue of proper firing angle control of converters at both the end, at the rectifier end, so also at the inverter end. And current is always limited to only 10 to 15% of the rated value. Okay. So generally in the AC network, what happens is that if there is a fault, then naturally the current will flow to the fault. Or maybe few cycles, then the relay will be able to detect the fault. And when the relay detects the fault, it will give the signal to circuit will breaker will open the contacts. Okay, then if the fault is a temporary in nature, then reclosure, auto reclosing is done. 2-3 attempts are done after a certain interval of maybe 0.5 or 1 or 2 seconds. Okay, if it fails, then that line is isolated, and such a process is followed in the AC networks. But in DC networks, circuit breakers are not adopted. Circuit breakers are rather not required, primarily because the converters do not allow current to be supplied into the fault. And secondly, a DC current, since it doesn't have any natural current zero, so the operation of circuit breaker practically is not really easy to achieve in case of high bulk power transmission DC circuits. Okay, because AC circuit breaker, they work on the principle of natural current zero crossing. So whenever current reaches zero, circuit breaker contacts are opened so that there is no resulting transient overvoltage. But in case of DC circuit, a very large amount of direct current related energy, it doesn't get dissipated easily, and hence it is very difficult to achieve zero current opening of the DC circuit breaker, if at all it is used in practice. So some theories are there that are proposed, like a commutation principle by using the alternative gap, okay, and then pre-charge capacitor. Those things we are going to see at a later stage in this chapter. So let us have discussion on the fault detection and fault clearing process. So first of all, we must realize that how the fault is detected in the DC network. So short circuit faults, generally it results in the rising fault current. Okay, and so also as fault current rises and the line is grounded, so there is a fall in the DC voltage. So these conditions are actually sensed by negative change in voltage with respect to time and positive change in current with respect to time. So if voltage is falling with respect to time, or time rate of change of voltage is negative, at the same time there is a rise in the current with respect to time. So dv by dt and di by dt, if they are dv by dt is negative, di by dt is positive, then this indicates that there is a short circuit fault taking place. So there some mechanism will be there which will continuously monitor the voltage and compare it with respect to time, calculate the derivative, and okay, so derivative type of controllers are there, so they will be able to detect this, right? Relay, they will detect positive changes in di by dt and negative changes in dv by dt. Okay, if both these exist, that means there is a fault, right? Now what will happen if such a fault is present, right? So naturally, fault when it exists on the line, so rectifier acts as a source for the line and inverter acts as a load. Generally, in the steady state operation, the rectifier works as a constant current controller and the inverter works with a constant extension angle control in the normal mode of operation. If there is a fault, then what happens is that the constant current controller modifies the rectifier voltage such that this sudden decrease in current is corrected. Okay, constant current controller, it will not allow current to flow beyond the set reference of the rectifier. That we have seen earlier in the discussion of converter controller characteristics, that maximum current that can flow on a DC line cannot be higher than the DC current reference of the rectifier. So rectifier continuously monitors the firing angle at the rectifier end, right, such that the sudden increase in the current is corrected. Current is, we have seen the equation, current is rectifier end voltage minus inverter end voltage upon some resistance values, isn't it? Some drops. So denominator has no control variable, but in the numerator, no, rectifier end voltage, current is increasing, so we have to restrict the rectifier end voltage. A small change in rectifier voltage will bring about a large change in the current. So firing angle is adjusted such that DC current is within the specified limit by a constant current control mechanism. Okay, right. Still, what will happen is that although we have restricted the current by a higher current reference, the fault current of the order of 10 to 15% of rated current, okay, still will continue to flow and feed the arcing fault. It will continue to flow through the fault. So generally in the AC network, if you observe, then the fault current is of the order of maybe 5, 6, 7 times the rated current. Very high current flows in the AC network. But in HVDC system, due to the converter controller, okay, which continuously senses the abnormal conditions and immediately alters the firing angle within less than one cycle time. In a microsecond, we can adjust the firing angle. So current is restricted to only 10 to 15% of the rated current value. That is quite remarkable. Fault current is limited only 10 to 15%. Okay. But still, it will continue to flow. Even if rectifier is trying to limit the current, but minimum it can set it to like this. Okay. The line voltage and line currents are reduced to zero for extinguishing the arc. In order to prevent even this much amount of current to flow through the ground in case of a line to ground fault, what happens is that both the converters, they are operated as an inverter. Both the converters, they are operated as inverter because fault current of some small amount is flowing. So this has to be restricted. Fine. After shifting, making these changes, still this much current flows. So the next action is that both the converters are gradually converted as inverter. So now rectifier also acts as a inverter, and inverter already is working as an inverter, isn't it? So that means there is no agency which is supplying current into the DC line, and consequently the line voltage as well as line current, these values are reduced to zero and arc is to be extinguished. Okay. So fault has occurred, right? Constant current control will not allow current to increase beyond the set reference. Still, fault, if it continues, 10 to 15% of rated current will continue to flow through the fault. That has to be minimized. So both the converters are operated as inverters. Next. After the arc is deionized, that means after operating both the converters in the inverter mode, a time of 0.5 second is allowed, fine, to check whether the fault is permanent or temporary. So many a times line to ground faults, they are temporary because they are due to lightning. The lightning discharge has taken place, lightning energy is discharged within a fraction of a second, and line can resume its operation. So the rectifier is brought back to the rectifier mode after 0.5 seconds. फिर से उसको वापिस rectifier mode में लेके आते हैं, क्योंकि lightning में क्या होता है, lightning गिरने के बाद में उसकी energy तुरंत discharge हो जाएगी, flash over हो गया, थोड़ी देर के लिए fault current गया, उसके बाद में उतने देर जब flash over हो जाने के बाद there will be a tracking on the insulator or maybe surface current will flow. After that, after 0.5 second delay, so we can again assume that a rectifier mode is brought back and DC voltage is gradually increased. Voltage ko dheere dheere bada ke dekhte hai. Theek hai? If the fault is temporary, then the DC line is restored. Temporary hai to DC line restored ho jayenge. Okay. But if fault continues, right, then the line is again de-energized. Upar jo process 1, 2, 3 mein humne bataya, fir se usko de-energize kar rahe hain. Constant current control, then both converter operating as inverter, then the energy that is trapped on the line due to lightning, that will be discharged to the ground. Okay. And what will happen is that following the above process, second re-energizing attempt is done. Okay. Second re-energizing attempt is done to reduce Okay. See, please remember that while we are trying to operate converters at both the end as an inverter, okay, the aim is to reduce the line voltage as well as line current to the zero value. Where is the current coming from? Current is coming from the AC networks, from the rectifier end, right? Fault has occurred due to lightning. But once the fault occurs, the line current also follows the fault path, and that we don't want. So to limit that, isn't it, we convert a rectifier into inverter mode. Current is brought to zero. Okay, so that is basically the idea. Okay, but still, if fault is permanent, then what will happen is that the DC line pole will be tripped, and similarly AC circuit breaker, okay, on the rectifier as well as inverter end, that will be tripped. So वो उस लाइन को फिर सर्विस से बाहर निकलना पड़ेगा. अगर फॉल्ट परमानेंट है, देन द यूजुअल फॉल्ट ट्रैकिंग प्रोसेस एंड देन कंप्लीट चेकिंग ऑफ द लाइन और मे बी थ्रू कैरियर प्रोटेक्शन स्कीम और समथिंग, ओके, सम मैकेनिज्म इज देयर टू डिटेक्ट द लोकेशन ऑफ द फॉल्ट एंड देन रिमूवल ऑफ दैट फॉल्ट एंड देन रिस्टोरिंग द लाइन बैक. टिल दैट टाइम मोनोपोलर ऑपरेशन विल कंटिन्यू. ओके, सो दैट इज द आइडिया how the fault clearing process takes place with respect to the short circuit or DC line faults. Okay, having studied the DC line fault and its fault clearing process, let us now move ahead to understand what are the different types of converter faults and what kind of protective schemes are there for converter faults. Converter is the most important part of the HVDC system, as it is here that conversion from AC power, it takes place into DC, isn't it, or maybe from DC to AC at the inverter end. So converters are very much integral part of the system and very important. At the same time, converters, these are solid state devices, thyristors, okay, or maybe in some case IGBTs, new technologies are coming up. So although they are handling a large amount of power, but these are solid state devices, and the advantage is that they have a very very fast response time. Once the trigger pulse is given, the operations take place, and very flexible operation and control can be done right from the rectifier mode to the inverter mode, and this can be done within very short time. So adjustments and control flexibility, all this is, these are the advantages. But the limitations of the solid state devices, especially with respect to the abnormal operating conditions, is that the converters, they being made up from solid state devices, they have a very limited, or we can say no overload capacity. Whatever is the rating, within that rating only they can operate. Otherwise, it leads to a failure. Okay, so care has to be taken to minimize any abnormal operating condition within the range, and it has to be taken care and removed. Faults are to be detected. So converter faults, let us consider what are the different types of converter faults. So converter faults are broadly classified into three major categories, as shown here in the form of a flow diagram. Okay, converter faults mainly they consist of first of all, fault in the thyristors or its controllers. Okay, that is malfunctioning of valves and controllers. This is there, right? Then the second type of converter faults, they are like very common, that is commutation failure. Especially this takes place at the inverter end of the HVDC system. And lastly, the third broader category is a short circuit within the converters. Okay, so all these are the three major categories of faults in converter. Now let us consider the valve and controller related faults. They are further subclassified in terms of various abnormal conditions. Okay, these are arc back, okay, conduction in the reverse direction. Okay, generally these arc backs are not really common with respect to the solid state devices. Then arc through or fire through, misfire, right? And then arc quenching or current extinction. We are going to see in detail and understand what is arc back, what is arc through, what is misfire and arc quenching or current extinction. Okay, these are all the different types of valve related or thyristor related faults, and controller, they are associated with controller as well, because thyristor closely work in association with the gate pulse generating circuit or the controller circuit which provides a gate pulse. So arc back, arc through, misfire, arc quenching, these are the faults. Then the next type of fault category is listed here as a commutation failure. So commutation failure means failure in transferring current from one thyristor to another in a sequence during steady state. This may occur due to various reasons, but commutation failure can be of different types: single commutation failure, double commutation failure, or double successive commutation failure, double not successive commutation failure. This also we are going to understand what are the different types at a later stage, right? And lastly, the third type of fault is a short circuit in converters. So let us consider these faults one by one. First and foremost, very common, and it's many times only a temporary fault, self-clearing type of fault with a minor adjustment in the firing angle of converter. Okay, commutation failure. It is a failure to transfer current, okay, from conducting valve to the successive incoming valve. You might have realized while studying in power electronics that in a bridge circuit, steady state three phase bridge, at any point of time, two or three thyristors are in conduction. So their sequence is also numbered in a serial manner, like 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, 5, 5, 6, and then 6, 1. So you can see 1, 2, then 2, 3. So current conduction from 1 is taken over by 3 in the every 60 degrees interval. So that is what is called as a commutation, transfer of current. And commutation failure means that from 1, 2 to 2, 3, 3 does not take over the current from 1. In that case, it is called as a commutation failure. Okay, so commutation failure. Failure to transfer current from one pair of thyristor, or rather one thyristor to another thyristor in sequence. Okay, so that is a commutation failure. A very common fault. That's why commutation failure, we have considered it at very first. Very common, especially at the inverter end. And the minimum value of extinction angle must be higher than the deionization time. So this we have been discussing in the constant extinction angle control method, that there is some time required for thyristor to turn off. So that time, the extinction angle should be higher than this. Because if extinction angle is smaller than the deionization time of thyristor, then thyristor will not turn off. And the next cycle, the voltage becomes positive and current will not be transferred. The same thyristor will continue to conduct, which was about to turn off. Okay. So that is the idea, commutation failure. Failure to transfer current from conducting thyristor or valve to the incoming valve. Okay. So let us say thyristor pair 1, 2 is conducting, then it becomes 2, 3. So 1 has to transfer current to 3. Okay. 2 is already in conduction. So 3 fails to take over because 1 did not turn off. 1 did not turn off because its extinction angle may be smaller than the turn off time. Okay. So that is the idea of commutation failure. Let us see the definition for the other types of faults also. Please understand that the reduction in the DC voltage or increase in the DC current can result in overlap angle, okay, mu, and extinction angle to decrease. Okay, so the reason mainly for the reduction in the extinction angle is specified here is due to the operating condition where DC current rises and DC voltage will fall, leading to increase in the commutation overlap. So commutation overlap, if it increases, then the extinction angle will decrease. Okay. So this is very obvious because the angle beta, angle of advance depends upon commutation overlap and extinction angle. Okay. Now let us consider the next type of fault, that is arc back. Arc back simply means back, the word indicates conduction in the reverse direction. Okay. And this indicates the loss of unidirectional property of the wall. Okay. In this case, the wall conducts in the reverse direction, and this can result in a three-phase short circuit on the AC side. So generally, this type of faults are not experienced with the thyristor walls. Okay. Generally, जो पुराने vacuum tube type के जो walls थे, उसमें arc back होते थे. लेकिन thyristor जो solid state devices है, उसमें इस तरह के faults generally नहीं होते. Not experienced in the thyristor walls. So this arc back is mainly for the very old type of vacuum tube walls, which are not in use at present. But we must know what is arc back, so that is why it is defined. Now let us consider the arc through, the next type of fault. It is the conduction of wall during the scheduled blocking period. Okay, conduction of wall during scheduled blocking period. So this is associated with the inverter walls. As I said, most of these kind of faults, they are especially inverter fault, which have a positive voltage in the forward direction for most of the time, and it is generally caused due to spurious gate pulse. The inverter side mein kya hota hai ki inverter is operated with a firing angle greater than 90 degrees, right? So consequently, for inverter operation, most of the time there is a positive voltage applied across the thyristor even during its blocking period when it is not conducting. Suppose there is a thyristor which is, let us say, thyristor number 2 is not working, okay, during a cycle, isn't it? But then there will be a positive voltage appearing for a longer duration, especially for the inverter. Inverter end pe zyadatar walls ke across zyadatar samay forward voltage applied rehta hai. अगर गलती से कोई इंड्यूस वोल्टेज हो गया, अगर पल्स गेट सर्किट में, दैट विल मेक कॉल थायरिस्टर टू गेट टर्न्ड ऑन. सो देयर स्पूरियस गेट पल्स, वोल्टेज इंड्यूस हो गया. ये काफी सेंसिटिव रहता है गेट पल्स सर्किट, ड्यू टू सम इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक फील्ड और मे बी समथिंग, सम इंड्यूस्ड वोल्टेज स्पूरियस गेट पल्स में अपीयर एंड थायरिस्टर में स्टार्ट कंडक्टिंग व्हेन इट इज सपोज नॉट टू कंडक्ट ब्लॉकिंग पीरियड. ओके, कंडक्ट नहीं करना चाहिए था, लेकिन बाय चांस गलती से सिग्नल मिल गया उसको और वो कंडक्शन हो गया, तो शॉर्ट सर्किट होने का चांस है. ओके, सो दैट इज व्हाट द आइडिया फॉर द आर्क थ्रू.